Good morning, church. How are we all? I see we're all on that side today, where the heater is. No coincidence, I'm sure. I want to start this morning with Psalms 86. Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart that I may fear your name. Wouldn't it be nice to have an undivided heart? I will praise you, O Lord my God, with all my heart. I will glorify your name forever, for great is your love towards me. Isn't he a wonderful God? That's why we're here today. We worship our Lord. It's my privilege to welcome you all here. It's good to see so many faces, and thank you for coming. Probably two announcements, but one fairly important one. It is in the newsletter, and it was there last week, but I feel we should probably make some mention of it. You might remember in March, I think it was, we, on the fifth Sabbath of the month, I think it was March, pretty sure it was March, we had church in the park. So next week is something similar. Although next week will be colder than March was. So next week we're planning on doing church around a bonfire. Now, don't be too upset at me. Church is not a building, church is a people, remember? So next week we will be having Sabbath school here at 10:30. That will run until about 12. Then we'll be dismissed for lunch. And then at 3 o'clock, we'll be having what you can consider your church program around a bonfire at the Mars place. Now, if you need directions, talk to Daniel or myself if you like. But that is the program for next week. Yes, it is different, but different is good. We like different. So that is what we'll be doing next week. So 10:30, Sabbath school here, and then 3 o'clock, at the Mars for church bonfire. Please remember, if you plan to come out to the Mars, you'll need your chair and also bring something we recommend for tea. We won't be there all night, but we might be there close to those hours. So hopefully we can get as many people there as possible. So we look forward to seeing you all there. Alrighty, it's time for our first song. And I'm going to invite Gemma up because she's going to play for us today. And I've got some singers who are coming to help me. So if I've asked you to come and help, if you'd like to come up the front. And thank you for our wonderful singers who have come to help today.
Solid ground, firm through the fierce and strong. Morning, everybody. Now, I just happened to be watching the cricket, as you do, the other night. And I was watching our bumbling captain. He was setting wrong field placings. He was dropping catches. And then I flicked over to the soccer. And our captain wasn't even playing. She'd done a calf muscle, and it got me thinking, aren't we glad that we worship our captain who never lets us down, doesn't make mistakes, and we can always rely on him. Anyway, with that in mind, I invite those who can kneel to kneel, otherwise just bow your heads. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for all the many times that you've blessed us and let us out of trouble. Thank you, Lord, that we can always rely on you. We can come to you at any time, and you're more than happy. And in fact, love it when we come to you and ask you or tell you anything that is on our mind. Thank you for all the blessings, Lord. Each and every day, there's countless times when you look out for us, protect us. The Holy Spirit will put on our hearts or our minds something that is in your will. Then there's those times, Lord, when we let you down. And they are probably more often than we like to think. We pray forgiveness for those times, Lord. We pray that if we do see ourselves falling, that you'll step in, give us a little tap on the shoulder and say, hey, and let us be humble enough to answer those pleadings. Lord, we pray for Amidi at the moment, who's travelling. He lost his grandfather. We pray that you'll be with him, with the family involved, and give comfort in this time. There's lots of other people that we need to be praying for, Lord, and my memory is starting to fail me, but you know who they are and what their needs are. So we pray that you'll be with those people, give them peace in whatever battles is going on in their lives. Be with Daniel this morning as he opens your word. Anoint his lips, and may we all receive a rich blessing, and we leave this place in better nick than when we walked in. We pray all these things in your loving name. Amen. Now, there's just going to be a short 3-minute video just before the deacons take up the offering.
Ellie received a text message that changed her life. Her friend was inviting her to be a volunteer teacher in a place she had never heard of before, Chuuk, a small island in Micronesia. Ellie discovered that the Chuuk Seventh-day Adventist School was in dire need of teachers, with only 6 teachers for 150 students. After praying for guidance, Ellie filled out an application and boarded a plane to Micronesia, unsure what to expect. Upon arrival, Ellie was struck by the contrast between Chuck's modern appearance and the hold that traditional spiritual beliefs still had over the people. She even heard a story about a possessed boy staring off into space and not acknowledging anyone. Despite the challenges, Ellie feels that her work at Chuuk School is making a real difference in the lives of her students and the community. Most students come from non-Adventist families, making the school a mission school. Although some days are difficult, Ellie believes that God put her in Chuuk for a reason and gives her the strength she needs to serve him. She has learned that our own goodness or capability doesn't always measure success in our Christian walk, but by how we listen to and obey God's voice. Through Ellie's experience, we can see that God is calling each of us to stretch our faith on behalf of His end time mission. Whether that means going where He calls us or returning to Him tithes and promise, which is our regular and systematic offering. The promise offering is not motivated by feelings, sympathy for missionaries and ministries, or even because there is a need or a good project. Promise offering is a regular offering because it is given as frequently as we receive a financial blessing or income from Him. It is given not in expectations of God's blessings, but in response to His care every time He blesses us financially. Promise offering is systematic because it is given under the proportional system. It is called promise because we need to prayerfully purpose about the frequency and percentage of the income that will be regularly dedicated to the Lord as an offering for a certain period. Then we may renew that percentage-based vow when the period is over, proposing the same or a different percentage. Following Ellie's commitment to God's mission, you may ask God in prayer now which percentage of your income He is inviting you to return to Him regularly and systematically as your promise offering. By returning regularly and systematically your tithe and promise offering, you partner with Him in preaching His final message to every nation, tribe, and tongue before He comes. May we put our desires last and God first.
I now invite the deacons to come and take up the offering. Dear Father in heaven, put a prayer blessing on this offering that was cheerfully given. May the tithes and offerings go to further your work, Lord, and bring your second coming nearer. We pray these things in your loving name. Amen.
It's now time for our second song. I'd like to invite my singers back up again. Thank you. Give Thanks. It's a song we haven't sung for a little while, but I think we all know it. What's our response to God? No matter where we are, we should give thanks to Him. And that's what we're encouraged to do in this song. So please stand. Again, short introduction and we're into it.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks.
Thank you all. It's now time for our children's story, and I'd like to invite all our children up the front. And Ray has got a very special story for us today.
Hello.
Okay.
Good morning. How are you, children? That's good. That's fantastic. I was wondering if I can have a couple of volunteers. Yep.
One.
Yep. Another one. Yep. You. Yes. If you could come up the front here. There we go. Now, is there anybody here who can tell me what this is? Yes?
It's a
mackerel. Yes, can you tell me what this is? Anybody? Well, this is called a compass, and it helps to tell you which way you're going, how to find the places that you're going to, and it keeps you on course. Now, once when I was a wee young fella, and we went on a Pathfinder camp, and we went up to a place called Mount Howard, and we got up there and we looked across in the distance and we could see Mount Cobbler. So we got out our compass and we took a bearing on Mount Cobbler from Mount Howard. And then once we got that, we practically run down the side of the mountain and we're going through the bush. The only thing was, we couldn't see where we were going because the bush was so tall and we were so small. But we kept on looking at our compass. We kept on taking the bearing and say, oh, a little bit that way, or oh, a little bit that way, straight ahead. So we kept on going by what the compass told us to do. And we kept on going through the bush, and we eventually came up to Mount Cobbler. And it's 15 kilometres away through the bush. And what you need to do today is to look to your compass, to look to Jesus. Jesus is our compass. And if we keep looking to him, we'll find our way. There's a lot of things around, stuff that we can't see through, stuff that we don't know what's there. But if we consult Jesus, we keep on looking to him, every day we'll get through life and we'll get through to where we're going, which is the heavenly kingdom. I thank you very much, girls and boys, for your attendance. Thank you. You can go back to your seats now.
Thank you, Ray. Selling Pathfinders already. I thought you were going to say you got lost or something. We'll keep that bit quiet. Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Daniel. I'm the minister here at Bendigo, and you're all very welcome to be here. Just a little slight correction on the bonfire thing. It's not going to be a full-on bonfire like it was last time. It will be a campfire. It'll be equally warm. Well, it'll be warm enough. The problem with the bonfire was it was so hot that you couldn't sit anywhere near it. This will be a little smaller, a little longer burning, and there's rocks around. So there's places where we might be able to just sit on the ground if you want to bring a rug or something like that. But yeah, if you've got a chair, feel free to bring it. So if you're tough, otherwise you can just come to Sabbath School and I'll plan to be there myself. That'll be good fun too. Let's pray, and I'll appreciate you pray with me. Our Father in heaven, thank you for your word that is a compass to us, pointing us to Jesus. And I thank you for your Holy Spirit. Without your Spirit, we can do nothing. Without your Spirit, we're wasting our time. And so, Lord, I pray that you would send your Spirit to be with us in our hearts. Make us ready to hear. Make me ready to hear what you want to say and to share it with others as well. Lord, I pray that you do this for the sake of Jesus, who died for us. Amen. All right. What would you say if someone asked you, where in the Bible does it say I should keep the Sabbath? Exodus 20. All right. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor your foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Anything else? Genesis 2, verse 3. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he rested from all the work of creating that he had done. Anything else? Aha, Mr. Controversial in the back. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and as his disciples walked along, they began to pick some heads of grain. The Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are they doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath?" He answered, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need? In the days of Abiathar the high priest, he entered the house of God and ate the consecrated bread, which is lawful only for the priests to eat. And he also gave some to his companions." Claude's smiling, so he's expecting something else apart from this, I think. Then he said to him, "The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." Yeah, that's Claude was waiting for that one. All right. Anyone else? Revelation 14:12. I haven't got that one written down, I don't think. What's that one, Helga? Aha, okay, right. You've got an extra logical step in there. Commandments of God. Anything else? Matthew 5:17. Okay. I think I know where that's going. The Sermon on the Mount. All right. Think not that I've come to destroy the law. I'm not talking about the law, though. I'm talking about the Sabbath. Isaiah 58. Oh, I see. Isaiah 66. Yes, so in heaven we'll be keeping the Sabbath and the new moon festivals too, apparently. Or Isaiah 58. If you keep your feet from breaking the Sabbath, from doing as you please on my holy day, if you call the Sabbath a delight and the Lord's holy day honorable, and if you honor it by not going your own way and not doing as you please or speaking idle words, then you will find your joy in the Lord. And I will cause you to ride in triumph on the heights of the land and to feast on the inheritance of your father Jacob, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Maybe we don't read that often enough. Anything else? Sorry? Deuteronomy, is it 5 or 15? Are you thinking of... Is it about the Sabbath? Which one is it? Oh, Deuteronomy 5:15. Oh, 12. I've got 15. 12 to 15 I've got. Observe the Sabbath day by keeping... It's the same as Exodus 20, basically. Not quite. Almost. Observe the Sabbath day by keeping it holy, as the Lord your God has commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, your male or female servant, nor your ox, nor your donkey, or any of your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns, so that your male and female servants may rest as you do. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt, and that the Lord your God brought you out of there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God has commanded you to observe the Sabbath day. There's a different motivation, isn't there? Anything else? Ezekiel 20, there's a few verses in here. I've got 19 and 20. I am the Lord your God. Follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. Keep my Sabbaths holy, that they may be a sign between us. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God. I haven't got it in front of me, but I believe you. Yeah, Ezekiel often has multiple little drips of things going all the way through. Matthew 12, verse 12. How much more valuable is a person than a sheep? Therefore, it is lawful to do good on the Sabbath. Yeah. Mark 2. Sorry? Mark 2, verse 27. Yes, I think I might... No, actually, did I read that? No, I didn't. Sorry, yes, I did. I did read that one, yes. What I was looking at was Luke 13, 10 to 17, which I haven't read yet. So I'll read that for you. See if this is a familiar story. Put up your hand if you're not sure you've heard this story before. On a Sabbath, Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues. Don't decide if you've heard it yet. And a woman was there who had been crippled by a spirit. Now, all right, you say, oh, of course I've heard of that before. Yeah, but you've probably more often heard of a man being the one there, right? Well, this is a different story, and this time it's a woman. This is only in Luke. A woman was there who had been crippled by a spirit for 18 years. She was bent over and could not straighten up at all. When Jesus saw her, he called her forward and said to her, woman, you are set free from your infirmity. Then he put his hands on her, and immediately she straightened up and praised God. What do you think the next word should be? How many of you guessed indignant? Well, that's what it is. Indignant, because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath. The synagogue leader said to the people, there are 6 days for work, so come and be healed on those days, not on the Sabbath. The Lord answered him, you hypocrites. Doesn't each of you on the Sabbath untie your ox or donkey from the stall and lead it out to give it water? Then should not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has kept bound for 18 long years, be set free on the Sabbath day from what bound her? When he said this, all his opponents were humiliated, but the people were delighted with all the wonderful things he was doing. Amen. Any others? All right. Yes, the market. Closing the gate. You want to read it? Yes, Matthew 24. What about this one? Romans 14, verse 5. One person considers one day more sacred than another. Another considers every day alike. Each of them should be fully convinced in his own mind. Not that one? We don't like that Bible verse? That's the Calathumpian Bible verse. When I was in Air Force Cadets, our commanding officer called himself a Calathumpian. Every time we had church parade where we went to church, he would always make a point of emphasizing that he himself was not religious. He was a Calathumpian, and that means that he doesn't take any day, doesn't see any day as being holy. He goes to work. Every day is the same to me, Christmas, Easter, Sunday, I don't care. I should have told him about this verse. He would have liked it. This would have been his favorite Bible verse. One person considers one day more sacred than another. Another considers every day alike. Each of them should be fully convinced in their own mind. What do you think? Was he a good Bible-believing Calathumpian? What about this one? Colossians 2:16-17. Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. Okay. So is the Sabbath a Sabbath or not? Is it a day of rest or not? Okay. So we can establish that. What about Hebrews chapter 4, 9-10? Maybe you have heard this one used, but maybe not as often as you would expect. There remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For anyone who enters God's rest also rests from their works, just as God did from his. Now here is a New Testament verse that actually says there is still remaining a Sabbath rest for us. So why don't we always quote it? Right, verse 11 says, let us therefore make every effort to enter that rest so that no one will perish by following their example of disobedience. But yeah, it's saying in verse 9 and 10, we're resting in Jesus. Maybe that's why we don't quote this verse as often, because it makes us feel like maybe the Sabbath that we're keeping is not about the law. Maybe somehow it's about Jesus. And that's threatening to us, right? Slightly threatening. Yeah, slightly. And when other people quote these verses to us, that is exactly what they're saying, right? You know, it doesn't matter what day I keep. All that matters is I love Jesus. So should we maybe take the book of Colossians out of the Bible? Should we just kind of explain it away? Just say, yeah, but. Yeah, I believe that Bible verse. I like that Bible verse. It's very good, but it doesn't apply. I suppose there's always something in the Bible that we have trouble explaining, isn't there? It doesn't matter what we believe or what our doctrines are or dogmas are. There's always something in the Bible that is tricky for us. So how do we approach Scripture so that we can not feel afraid of it? Because I do think we need to be a bit careful with the writings of Paul, particularly. After all, Peter himself says that Paul is easy to be misunderstood, and that people who don't understand what Paul is trying to say have misunderstood his writings and used it for false teaching. Is that true or is that true? Very true. There's a lot of false beliefs people find in the writings of Paul. But does that mean we should throw Paul away? Does that mean we shouldn't read about the marvels of salvation by grace that he explains to us? Not that the rest of the Bible doesn't teach it, but he actually explains it specifically to us to make sure that we understand, that we get the point that Jesus is giving it to us as a gift. It's not being, you know, you're born into it, or maybe you earn it if you work hard enough, if you do all the right things, obey all the right rituals. It's a gift. And Paul makes that clear to us. So we don't want to throw away Paul. Nor do we want to throw away Moses. Sure, Moses says some weird stuff, which I guess made a lot of sense in the Bronze Age. But he has precious truth. Love the Lord your God with all your heart. Love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus was taking that from Moses. The Lord is one. Even the Trinity comes from Moses. And yes, remember the Sabbath. That is also precious truth. If we reject the Sabbath, we end up saying, well, that part of the Bible isn't relevant to me. That part of the Bible is just for Jews. So where do we draw the line? All scripture is given Right. All scripture, including Colossians 2, 16 and 17. All right. Where do we draw the line? Because there are some things in Moses' law that we don't keep, right? We don't stone Sabbath breakers. Maybe some of us would like to. I don't know. I'm hoping that's a no. So there's some things we don't do. Why not? Where do we draw the line? How do we understand? How do we interpret what we're reading, that we know if it relates to us or not? New Testament, maybe, right? Or I've heard others say the cross. Whatever's after the cross is new covenant. Whatever's before the cross is old covenant.
Shouldn't we be following what Jesus did? If we have a question,
should right. we So do we do that with the Sabbath?
Well, I'm yielding one lately.
Okay. Some people do, though. Some people work at hospitals. Although it's pretty hard to stay on top of your spiritual life if every Sabbath you're working in a hospital, right? But still, right, why is that acceptable? Because you're healing on the Sabbath. I'll tell you a story of my experience. Soon after I started keeping the Sabbath, my grandmother passed away, and Mum Eddie, condolences to you about your grandmother. My grandmother passed away, and I asked the executors, please don't have the funeral on Saturday. Now, you know, most funerals are not on weekends. Most funerals are during the week, right? And I said, you know, I won't be able to come if it's on Saturday, because that's my Sabbath and I need to go to church that day. And so what day did they make it? Now, I'm not saying they did it maliciously. They just thought, they were Catholic. So they thought I would just get a dispensation, right? They thought it was just something that I just had to get a letter to say it's okay and it would be all good. That's the thinking, right? That's not our thinking, is it? All right? Although if you do want me to write a letter to your employer about keeping the Sabbath, I can do that. But yeah, I don't do dispensations. So I felt like, well, okay, I told them that I couldn't come if it was on Saturday, so I guess I can't come. And I appreciate my sister, who is not an Adventist, but she said I should talk to my pastor about it. Because I think from where I was standing, I was trying to be principled and take a principled stand. I was trying to do what was right. And to me, the option was there. I had said, you know, that I couldn't go on a Saturday. I could go any other day of the week, but not that. And they'd chosen not to account for me. So that was their choice, not mine, right? I've got to stand for principle. Obviously, not everyone else saw it that way. But my pastor saw it a different way again, and I appreciate the advice he gave me. And I think he based it on what Jesus said. It is lawful to do good on the Sabbath. Now, you could say skipping church is not good. So how is it doing good to miss church? I'm not saying it is good to miss church, just in case you're wondering. And so we have to wrestle with this subtle difference, don't we? Sometimes we have to make a choice, and it's our choice to make. What is the greater good? What is the greater need? What do we really need to do in this situation? Is it just that I want to sleep in? Maybe in that instance, that's actually Satan trying to stop you going to church when you really, really need to. Is it a wedding, a funeral, some other special occasion where people need you to be there? I think if we follow Jesus' teaching of the Sabbath, the decision isn't so hard. We can see that it is lawful to do good on the Sabbath. You know, Jesus could have healed that woman some other day. He could have said, oh, I noticed that there's a sick woman in the church. Well, I'll just wait until after sunset, and then I will find her and I will heal her. She can't have been very hard to find, can she? He could have said, well, let's just wait. I might get in trouble with the church if I deal with this right now. I mean, he knew he would. Do you think Jesus was trying to make a point? What is the purpose of the Sabbath? Why do we keep the Sabbath? Is it because God needs us to do it? We need it. Jesus kept it. So what? Jesus wore sandals. You don't see me wearing sandals. Maybe I should make myself a pair sometime. So what if Jesus kept it? Why did he keep it? A gift. A gift. Right, in Genesis it said God blessed it, made it holy. What does that mean? A burden? Something to hurt us? A trial? A cross? We do have to bear our cross, don't we? And yet, the Sabbath was not made to be a cross. It was made to be a sign, a special thing. You might have heard the story of Desmond Doss, right? What did he do? He did his Sabbath school pamphlet on Sabbath, and the whole advance waited for him to finish his Sabbath school lesson, right? But he didn't refuse to walk. He didn't refuse to heal people. He didn't say, sorry, it's my day off. I'm not going to save you from your gunshot wounds. He was willing to work. What did the priests do in the Old Testament? When there were services to be done, when there were sacrifices to be made. Has anyone here butchered an animal, a live animal? Like killed a live animal? One or two, right? Easy job, right? Break a sweat? No way, man. So easy. It's hard physical work. The priest had to do that on the Sabbath. Now, I appreciate something that Renee said once in a Sabbath school lesson. Technically, I don't actually work on Sabbaths. I'm not paid for my work on Sabbaths. But, you know, if I decided I would never turn up to church, you would be on the phone to the conference, right? If I said, no, it's my day off. I'm not going to do anything today. There is work to be done on the Sabbath, but it's a special work. It's a different kind of work. But God doesn't say exactly what makes it so special. Don't we wish he would? Now, the Jews did that. What do they say in I believe it was Mark, wasn't it? The disciples are walking through the field, picking some heads of grain, rubbing it in their hands, getting the grains out and eating it. That was work, right? How many of you would pay someone to do that job? No? But it's work. The Jews had decided that it was work. Because technically, it was the same as if you're actually doing it on an industrial scale. Are we a bit like that sometimes? Now, is this technically work or not work? Can I do this? Can I eat out? Can I get petrol? Can I go to the hospital? Can I go to the pharmacist? I mean, I understand the dilemma. I get it. I feel the same way. I don't want to make them work on the Sabbath. But, you know, if you're bleeding out, what are you going to do? Of course you're going to go to the hospital. Of course you're going to call the ambulance. Maybe the problem is because we start with Exodus, and we start with the law, we start with do not do this, we miss the deeper point. It's not supposed to be a clear black and white thing that we can police and say, brother, you broke the Sabbath, you're in trouble, we're going to disfellowship you now. It's a law of love. The law is because God loves us. The law is a guide for us in our life. It is a blessing for us. It is something that God is giving to us for our good, for our benefit. And not the, it's for your own good kind of good, right? It's a blessing to us. But if we make it into a curse, if we make it into something that is bad, it ceases to be a blessing. And we ourselves are not keeping the Sabbath. If you ever meet a Jew and brag to them that you keep the Ten Commandments, they will not be very impressed. They will probably then say, why don't you keep all the other 613? But something else they might say, if you say, but I keep the Sabbath, they will say, we don't keep the Sabbath. The Sabbath keeps us. We celebrate the Sabbath. They've had a very long time to think about this. And they've lived in many different oppressive situations where they were murdered for their faith or for their ancestry, as the case may be. What about us? We haven't really faced a lot of persecution. Maybe sometimes we feel like that's something we need to seek out. We need to find something that we're persecuted in so that we can consider ourselves godly enough, strong enough. Maybe sometimes we make the rules stronger than they have to be so that we can get in trouble over them. I'm not trying to downplay the struggle of trying to keep the Sabbath. Work, telling you to come in and work on a Saturday, it's not easy to say no to that. I get it. But what is our motivation? What is driving us? Is it because we're afraid that we might be held guilty? Is it because we're afraid of judgment from God? Is it because we're afraid of hell? Or is it because we seek to make the day special? We want to make it the best day of the week. That's what Jesus teaches. That's what the whole Bible teaches. It's not about judging people. Who cares if this verse is talking about the Sabbath when it says, don't let anyone judge you? Who cares? It's not about judging. If you're judging someone or if they're judging you, they've missed the point. It's about a blessing that God has offered us. So, thank you for sharing in the blessing of the Sabbath. And next week, I hope that it will be a blessing again. Whether you want to take the time to relax at home and sleep in, Sabbath school starts at 10:30, so it's a little later for some of us. Gives us plenty of time still to talk afterwards. We can eat together and then come out, if you're brave, in the cold, bring a jacket. There'll be a fire, so hopefully it'll be warm at the fire. Whatever it is that our situation is in life, we can celebrate and enjoy the Sabbath. We can get the blessing by spending time with each other, spending time with God, and making it a special day where we really think the thoughts that God wants us to think. No idle words, no idle thoughts. Focus on Jesus in everything that we do. May everything we do, whether we are at church, at home, in the bush, working in a hospital, working in a coal mine, whatever we're doing, make it a special day for God. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we need you. We need you so much because life is complicated. Life is hard. You've given us laws, and they're good laws. They're for our blessing, but we struggle to know how to apply them. We struggle to know how to avoid causing conflict. We want to put that in your hands, Lord. Please take over our lives. Please take over our struggles. Take them and give to us the wisdom. Give to us the courage to do what is right and to enjoy the blessings that you've given us. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll have the final hymn. Our Father in heaven, thou art truly greater than our problems. And Lord, I pray that wherever we are, you would be in our minds, that you, your glory would fill us, that it may be contagious. And Lord, I thank you for everyone who is here today. I thank you for their choice to glorify you and meet together on your Sabbath. And I pray that we might make this day the most joyful of all. By your Holy Spirit, we ask, and by the name and the power of Jesus. Amen.